The first version of Photoshop I ever used was Photoshop 6.0, released an insane 20 years ago. As a graphic designer, I've done my fair share of scoffing whenever some sci-fi thriller or crime show would enhance some grainy CCTV footage and get a razor-sharp image out the other end. I've had enough experiences with clients providing thumbnail-sized JPEGs and expecting to miraculously blow them up to poster size to know the limits of software all too well. But over the last handful of years, something's changed. There's been a new suite of buzzwords: AI, machine learning, deep learning, and neural networks. At first, it seemed like marketing hype, and often with commercial software, it can be. But then I started watching the channel 2-Minute Papers and seeing the results being generated in machine learning research. I even fudged my way through running a few Jupyter notebooks on Google Colab for myself. And to be honest, it's made me reassess some things. So in this video, we'll take a critical look at some notable examples of Zoom and enhanced tech from fiction. Then we'll see how close machine learning research comes to bringing those ideas to reality in 2020. Is AI a magic bullet that will completely revolutionize image processing? Or is it just the latest flavor of technobabble hand-waving for lazy Hollywood hacks? Well, today,
I'm gonna get to the truth.
To begin with, let's embrace the meme with this classic enhance button treatment from CSI Miami.
There's the robber's vehicle.
Wait, go back a few frames. Look at that. They drive by and then they back up before they park. What about the car?
Plate's obstructed, it's not much.
Wait, what's that in the windshield?
Some kind of sticker. Miami University.
This has many of the hallmarks of bad zoom and enhance. An impractical graphic user interface controlled by keyboard without the mouse moving. For example, notice that the cursor on screen never moves. But more importantly, in the source video, we barely can make out the original subject. To be generous, it might be 4 pixels worth of information. But let's use our imagination and pretend that this security footage was actually shot in Ultra HD 4K, and that we're just scrubbing through some low-res proxy footage somehow in 2005 on a Pentium 4. If we start with the zoomed pre-enhanced image, things immediately aren't looking good. We can make out the 0.5, but the rest of the badge is a vague brown stain. Traditional bicubic resampling just makes a fuzzier brown stain. Can machine learning do any better? There are many research papers on upscaling or super resolution using a single source image, but let's start with the user-friendly option with some off-the-shelf solutions. Let's try Gigapixel AI from Topaz Labs, a standalone app, and let's also check out Adobe Photoshop's new Super Zoom feature currently in beta under their Neural Filters suite. Gigapixel tries in vain to find details to enlarge, but there's just not enough to work with. This image is only 22 by 16 pixels, nowhere near enough to resolve text. As context for our Latin alphabet, 5 pixels is the shortest possible height for legible bitmap fonts. What Gigapixel comes up with looks like a chunky tumbleweed. Photoshop does even worse. Super Zoom basically gives up at this tiny size. If I enlarge the image with traditional upscaling first, then run the learning-based method, we end up with a brown stain that's only marginally different and no clearer than the original pixel soup. So what's the minimum size which will give us legible text? Well, if we about double our input resolution, Gigapixel starts to show some promise. We can make out the zeros and twos well enough, but the one is still rough and LOT is starting to look like LCI. Photoshop needs even more pixels to get something usable, but realistically at these scales, neither app really does much in improving legibility compared to the untreated image, making the enhanced step pretty much redundant. However, in theory, things might be different if we used multiple video frames, not just one. In 2018, Google rolled out a feature on Pixel phones called Super Res Zoom. The research paper behind it was later presented at SIGGRAPH 2019. To boil it down simply, taking a photo on the Pixel actually takes a series of multiple images in quick succession, like frames of a high-speed video. Then, using machine learning, it pulls additional image details from the minute pixel-level differences between these images and synthesizes them into a larger, clearer image. Now, this leverages the involuntary movement in your hands, taking a photo on your phone, but in theory, an outdoor security camera recording a stationary subject might have enough variation thanks to wind movement to allow for similar post-processing. Unfortunately, Google haven't made their code open source, so we can't test that. So far, we have seen so much fiction, but let's see what's next.
Nat, how's it coming with the kidnapping footage?
I'm just enhancing a reflection from the car window.
Yeah, I'd like 3 cheeseburgers, 3 french fries, and 3 cherry pies.
Found a clean frame on one of the kidnappers.
Creepy thin man.
Oh, good, now we have a bad guy. All we have to do is look for him, find out if he works for Corwin.
So breaking it down, what's being enhanced in this scene is a reflection in a car window shot by a security camera. Let's put aside the issue of resolution we already dealt with in CSI. How plausible is it to extract a clean image from a reflection? Well, a research paper published this year called Learning to See Through Obstructions proposed a method of using a convolutional neural network to take a video input, including a reflection, and output separate reconstructed videos of the reflection and of the clean background. This technique uses data from multiple frames of video moving sideways in parallax, so it wouldn't work in this scenario with footage from the security camera. The results do show some visible artifacting, but separating a reflection and background is a task that would take days of intensive labor for each frame for a human technician, even for the highest skilled Photoshop guru or VFX artist. And to me, this is really quite impressive stuff. Then we have the upscaling of the face itself. Now, our previous example from CSI showed that this pixel count is really too small for text, but human faces are a special case. Machine learning requires huge amounts of training data, and some of the largest datasets have been human faces. So maybe there's some potential here. Well, a paper was released this year called Pulse, which tries to do exactly this. With a little bit of cleanup, we can feed this low-res image to Pulse and see what it comes up with. And I'd say most of these are passable as human faces, but as for matching the input photo, I feel the algorithm's imagination is a little too strong. The way the generative model works is it tries to make a result that, when downscaled back to pixels, fits well with the original low-res input. None of these really resemble the output that Cameron Diaz got, but then that's likely because that close-up is a completely different photo that was added in post-production. You can actually spot the original, enhanced photo still in her hand in the wide shot. So what happens if we take Pulse and work backwards from this other image? Well, the results are actually worse. This technique really works best with portraits that are taken straight on, and this image has Crispin Glover looking over his shoulder. Comparing the ground truth high-res image to the Pulse upscaled portraits, it's fair to say it does a pretty poor job at matching likenesses. If the Angels had used this tech, they'd have spent the remainder of the movie hunting for a half-melted John Travolta. It's not a unique problem to this particular model, but a very real problem in machine learning is underlying bias in training data. What comes out is going to resemble what goes in, and the training data is going to skew the results in a certain direction. We needn't look far to see evidence of this issue. This tweet of Pulse turning Barack Obama white went viral earlier this year, and there's a very important conversation to be had about the lack of diversity and other forms of unconscious bias baked into datasets that train these algorithms. The dataset that Pulse used for training is called Celeb A, composed of images of celebrities and other public figures. So, biases in the training data are not deliberate and malicious per se, but they are reflective of biases in our real celebrity culture. That's a huge topic and not the focus of this video, but if you're curious, I've linked some articles down in the description. Our final piece of Hollywood magic in this scene, of course, is going from a black and white image to a color photo. Now, we already saw some colorization in Pulse when we gave it a grayscale input. The resulting faces actually have a very light skin tone and clearly red lips. This again is a result of the training data bias. Since it was trained only on color images, it can only output color images regardless of input. But there are also specialized learning-based techniques for automatic colorization. One of the best known projects is called Deoldify, and here's how it processed a black and white version of our final image. Not bad as far as plausibility, but definitely it still has that colorized look. The skin tones look like one flat plane rather than the more natural variations of a color photo. But these techniques can only give us a plausible output, not a factual one, which leads us to our final clip.
This is the one showing promise. This is the security camera at the underwear store. Freeze there.
Rotate us 75 degrees around the vertical, please.
Freeze there.
Times 10.
Focus on the drop. Enhance, then forward, frame by frame. All right. Now, just before the view's blocked, there's a shape change in Dean's bag. See the shadow variance? See? The shadow's wrong. Zabbit's changed the configuration of Dean's packages.
Is it a tape?
It's hard to say for sure. These things are...
Computer take us around to the other side?
It can hypothesize, Chris.
What do you think it is?
It looks a lot bigger than the tape, so maybe it's nothing.
Maybe it's everything. Let's get it and find out.
Notorious. This scene is probably one of the most fantastical of all time. Surely this is pure science fiction. Or perhaps not. A paper called PIF UHD was released this year, which can take a single still photo of a person and generate a full 360 3D model. Machine learning can really do some amazing things with image processing. This is really cool research and would have been nearly unthinkable even as recently as 5 years ago. That said, let's see what it can do with this security footage. Our first problem is multiple subjects, so we need to isolate down to just the runner. The image is also cropped, so let's do a quick fudge to make a full-length image and run it through our model, and we get a monster made of oatmeal. So what went wrong? Well, first is our angle. All of the examples we see from the research paper are full-length portraits taken at eye level, not from overhead. Second issue is resolution. There's just not enough to work with here. And lastly, the movie actually got one thing dead on right.
It can hypothesize, Chris.
All of the results we've seen are purely theoretical. As we've seen, machine learning techniques are bringing sci-fi closer to reality than ever, but there are some limitations that AI will simply never overcome. No AI will be able to make information out of nothing. It can only ever synthesize a plausible solution. Just like if I show you this image of John McClane from the front, given the huge data set of life experience you have, you can probably guess pretty accurately what his back might look like. What you couldn't know, and no AI could ever work out, is whether he has a gun taped to his back with only the limited information you have. The failure cases with Pulse also illustrate this problem. When we know that this is a low-resolution photo of Lucy Liu, this is obviously a wrong solution, but that isn't the problem this algorithm is trying to solve. It's trying to synthesize a plausible human face that fits this series of low-resolution pixels. Even a theoretical, general, or strong AI would still be susceptible to the same traps that humans can fall for. Sure, Pulse gets this completely wrong, but could you correctly guess the subject of this image? It's not Obama, but his Indonesian doppelganger. It's impossible to tell at such a low res. Even a super intelligent AI would need to work off assumptions and probabilities where information is limited. That's why, impressive as it is, learning-based image manipulation is going to be a boon for the creative sector, but not for forensics. There's a reason why the term hallucination is used for extrapolated information produced by neural networks. If you think about it, it's not actually information, it doesn't reflect any reality. It's more like machine imagination. The techniques we've looked at today are very much still in their infancy. Machine learning, often called AI for marketing purposes, will become increasingly sophisticated, reliable, and commonplace in creative workflows. A lot of the bugs will get ironed out and refined over time. PIF UHD, for example, has poor temporal cohesion, That is what produces the flickering between frames in this final animation. This problem's already been hugely improved on in other image processing algorithms, and it's only a matter of time before further work fuses these ideas and creates a more refined version. It seems unlikely that deep image enhancement will truly be a one-click operation, and human aesthetic judgment will always be an important factor. But certainly the old days of manual Photoshop retouching are well behind us, and a new suite of tools is slowly replacing and sometimes augmenting the way that images are being processed. If you want to keep up with the latest research in machine learning and AI, I cannot recommend highly enough the YouTube channel 2-Minute Papers. Links also to all the original research down in the video description. The vast majority of people talking around AI and machine learning these days are unsurprisingly data scientists, people with a coding or academic background. I hope as a designer who's worked for years with traditional photo retouching and image processing workflows, I was able to share a different perspective on this topic. If you're interested in seeing more videos about how design, technology, and culture interact, subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And if you enjoyed this video, please offer a like to the almighty algorithm. Also, let me know in the comments below what your favorite zoom-in enhanced scene is from a movie or TV show. I'm wondering which are the ones that have stuck with people over the years. And if you're interested in this topic, I have a lighthearted end-of-year video, including some neural filters and memes, which will also be coming up on the channel soon. As always, my name is Linus. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope I'll see you in a future video.